Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Worship Online with St. Luke United Methodist Church. We are a small church located in central Austin, downtown. We're so blessed to gather together in spirit to worship Jesus Christ. Today is a special day as we have a guest preacher joining us this morning. Victoria Volker is a member here at St. Luke and is currently a seminary student at Iowa School of Theology in Denver. Victoria recently embarked on the journey to become a clergy person in the United Methodist Church. It's wonderful to have a new, fresh perspective, and we're eager to hear her message this morning. Will you join with me in the call to worship? Live in God's love. Let that love be poured out for all God's people. Bring hope and peace to all whom you meet. We are called to be God's witnesses. Celebrate and rejoice. Praise be to God who has called, healed, and given us a ministry of peace. Amen. Let our hearts and minds find quiet rest in Christ this morning as we worship together. Our prelude will be played by Adam Roberts, our music director. Let us pray together. Source of all creation, maker of the world and everything in it, you are never far from each one of us. We come to worship today seeking you, O giver of life and breath. Reveal yourself to us, dwell with us, abide in us. We live because of you. We hope because of you. In the name of Jesus Christ, in whom we live, and in the Spirit of truth who abides in us, we pray. Amen. Will you join with us as we sing our hymn of praise this morning? It's number 185 in the United Methodist Red Hymnal. It's When Morning Gilds the Skies. The words will also be on your screen. We'll sing verses 1-3 as Adam leads us.
When morning gilds the skies, my heart awaking cries, may Jesus Christ be praised, alike at work and prayer, to Jesus I repair, may Jesus Christ be day when from the heart we say, may Jesus Christ be praised, the powers of darkness fear, when this sweet chant they hear, may Jesus Christ be praised.
Friends, when we gather together in body or in spirit, and we lift each other up in prayer, God is present with us. God is always present with us. But we come together and we pray for one another and for our world, and this morning I'd like to offer a special prayer of intercession. It's written by the Reverend Dr. Manhong Melissa Lin of the China Christian Council. Would you pray with me? Holy God, when human life is disturbed, disrupted, and threatened by the novel coronavirus, we pray to you, God of life. Grant us the compassion, humility, and self-discipline to value, care about, and protect each life. We pray to you, God of mercy, for all who have suffered directly and indirectly during this global pandemic. May you sustain, console, and heal them. We pray to you, God of peace, for all goodness and good efforts to rescue life and to maintain people's health. May you strengthen, guide, and protect all who have committed to fight against the disease. We pray to you, God of righteousness, for justice to prevail. May you lead us to combat racism, discrimination, stigmatization, and xenophobia with courage in the midst of this health crisis. We pray to you, God of love, for an early end to the transmission of COVID-19 that is harming all, and for life, health, and peace for all, through your mercy, grace, and loving care, and through human solidarity, integrity, and mutual support. Amen. Amen. Let us sing together our hymn of prayer, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. The words will be on your screen, will be led by Stephen Castillo.
I Jesus, keep me from my wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through this world of toils and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. And when my time on earth is o'er, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely o'er to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Friends, if you were worshiping with us last week, you would have heard me speaking about the support that we give to Family Elder Care. They have a summer fan drive. It's their 30th anniversary this year, and we at St. Luke have been participating for a long time. Typically, we collect fans, people bring them here to the church, and then we take them to Family Elder Care. But this year, because of the novel coronavirus, we are doing something a little bit different. Instead, we are taking monetary donations. You can donate online at stlukeaustin.com, or you can send in a check to St. Luke at 1306 West Lynn Street in Austin, Texas. 78703 is our zip code. Just make a note that it's for the fan drive. We're collecting funds so that we can hopefully meet our goal of sharing 60 fans with Family Elder Care. I hope that you would help us to meet that goal. Friends, I thank you for your continued support of St. Luke and the ministries and the mission that we do here. Without your continued support, we would not be able to serve this community working for God's peace, hope, love, and justice in the world. Let us have a prayer for our offerings this morning. Giver of all gifts, we are grateful for your every blessing and for your presence through all of life. In our joys and fears, in our hopes and our dreads. We pray for those who do not know your presence in their lives. We ask that you would reveal yourself to them through the gifts we have given and through the lives that we live. Reveal yourself, O God, that all your children may find their true home in you, we pray. Amen. Will you join with me in a hymn of praise? We'll sing Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. If you have a Red United Methodist hymnal at home, it's hymn number 139. We'll sing verses 1 through 3, but the words will also be on your screen. Let's make a joyful noise to the Lord.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation.
When we gather together for worship here at St. Luke, we always have a children's moment, and the kids come running down the aisles, and it's really one of the highlights of my morning to celebrate and worship with the kiddos. If you have kids with you right now, would you gather them around the screen? I have a special message to share with them this morning. Hi, kids. I miss you all. I cannot wait for us to get back together to worship in person, but until then, we're staying safe, we're sheltering at home, and that's a good thing. It's a good thing. This week, as I was studying scripture, it was on my heart about how confusing the Bible can be sometimes. Sometimes it's really hard to understand what Jesus is saying or what God is speaking through the text. Sometimes when I am really struggling with a text, I notice that God gives me a picture in my mind, an idea in my mind that helps me to kind of understand the text. And that happened this week, and I wanted to tell you the story of it. I was reading in the Gospel of John in chapter 14, verses 15 through 21, and I was a little bit confused. And then God gave me a beautiful picture that I want to share with you. So hear this text. See if you find yourself being confused too. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you desolate. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me, and because I live, you will also live. In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He who has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." Did you follow all of that? Especially the part that says, "Yet a little while the world will see me no more, but you will see me because I live, you will live also. In that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you." It's this back and forth and back and forth. And it reminded me of knitting or crocheting or weaving. I don't know if you know what weaving is. It's when you take a thread, maybe like this red yarn that I chose. I chose this when I was digging in the closet red yarn because it reminded me of Pentecost. In a couple weeks, we're going to be celebrating Pentecost, and we wear reds and pinks and oranges and fuchsias, bright, bright red, fiery colors to remind us of the time the Holy Spirit came. So I chose this red, and then I found this blue yarn in the cupboard as well, and the blue reminds me of Jesus coming to the world as a babe. Because this blue is like soft, like a baby blanket. So it made me think of Jesus coming to the world as a baby. And I found this purple yarn, and purple reminds me of the king. Purple is a royal color, and so it reminds me of the king. We sometimes talk about Christ the King or God's kingdom. And so these three colors I chose because they reminded me of God altogether. And then I found this really cool ball of yarn in the cabinet. I'm not sure if you can see all the colors, the creams and the pinks and the blues, so many different colors. And I was thinking that this is like people. People come in so many different hues, so many different colors. And I loved that. And I was thinking about how when we weave these yarns together or crochet these yarns together, something amazing happens that reminds me of the kingdom of God, of the church. And I want to show it to you right now. Do you see this beautiful blanket? And it has all these different colors in it, blues and pinks and yellows, but it's woven together, it's crocheted together. I don't know who made this, but when you weave things together, they become stronger. This thread on its own, if you pulled it hard enough, you could break it. But I can't imagine that we could pull hard enough on this blanket to break it. When we get woven together with God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, or Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, when we get woven together, we become stronger together. And it's really cool to me that God weaves God's people, all creation, together with God's self to make something stronger. But this blanket is not only just stronger, it provides warmth and comfort. It brings us joy when we wrap ourselves up in it. And that reminds me of the family of God, about what happens to us when we get woven up with one another and with God. We become stronger, but we also are a source of comfort and love and warmth to others. That's such a cool thing. And I wonder if that was the picture that God was trying to give me as I was reading that text this week. Sometimes God speaks to us in pictures as we're reading the Holy Word. And that's a cool thing. Let's have a prayer over that today. And we'll pray that God would help knit us together, weave us together with God and with one another. Holy God, we give you thanks for weaving us to yourself and weaving us to one another to make something stronger, something that brings comfort and warmth to the world. We thank you, God, for your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together a hymn. It's hymn number 62, All Creatures of Our God and King.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise him, alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. rushing wind that art so strong. Ye clouds that sail in heaven not long, oh, praise Him, alleluia. Thou rising morning, praise, rejoice. Ye lights of evening, find a voice. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia. Let all things their Creator bless, and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, alleluia, alleluia.
Will you join me in the prayer for illumination? Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Psalm 66, verses 8 through 20. Hear these words. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept us among the living and has not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tested. You have brought us into the net. You laid burdens on our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water, yet you have brought us out to a spacious place. I will come into your house with burnt offerings. I will pay you my vows, those that my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble. I will offer to you burnt offerings of fatlings. With the smoke of the sacrifice of rams, I will make an offering of bulls and goats. Selah. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell what God has done for me. I cried aloud to him, and he was extolled with my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly God has listened. He has given heed to the words of my prayer. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love for me. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We're so grateful to have Victoria Volker preaching this morning, and so we'll turn to her to hear her word.
Good morning, everyone. I am so excited to be giving the message this morning, especially because y'all are my family and being far away from y'all in Waco has been challenging. So I hope you enjoyed the reading of Psalm 66. Let's get started. So I looked it up, and it turns out that one of the names given to Psalm 66 is To the Chief Musician. To the Chief Musician. Isn't that a wonderful way of calling God? The lead creator, conductor, designer of sounds that create harmony, provoke feeling, and spur us into movement. Who wouldn't want to praise a God like that? a God that creates music, melodies, vast symphonies, moving pieces of art that have no words and yet contain every expression of human emotion possible. I'm here for a God like that. Especially when most of the time I feel like God is portrayed as angry. You know, the kind of God I'm talking about. The one that needs you to come to church, to repent of your sins, and to never, ever, ever forget that it is only by God's grace that your sins have been forgiven. The God portrayed in this psalm, though, is musical, loving, and creative. A God that loves us and creates through us a breathtaking and beautiful world. These two versions of God have been extolled and despised in equal measure by Christians and non-Christians alike throughout history. So it isn't surprising to me that all those centuries ago, faithful Jews would have penned a psalm singing the praises of the kind of God they desired to be in a relationship with the most, that chief musician God. We all want an intimate relationship with the chief musician. After all, a chief musician is awe-inspiring, and if there's anything we want from God, it's to feel awe. When we feel awe, we become small, dwarfed by something larger than ourselves. We can let go of feeling like we have to be in charge of everything all the time. Don't you love that feeling? That's why I think Christians love the Psalms so much. They capture the adoration the Jews had for a God that was bigger than them, stronger than them, and whose existence meant that they would not have to know or be everything in the world. Why do you think we sing songs about the power of God in church now? It's because we love to raise our hands and feel the energy of the song take over and in some small way replicate the feeling of God being in charge. When I visited London last summer, one of the first places I went after dropping off my bags at my friend's apartment was to Westminster Abbey. It's funny because when you come up on the Abbey, you're just walking down a busy London street. Everything is old and architecturally stunning. You can hear the Thames River nearby, and then all of a sudden, bam, there you are. Parliament on your left, Westminster Abbey on your right. If you ask me, it's like way too much for a non-British person to handle, and they should probably, you know, tone it down a bit. But that's where the awe happened. I stood there with just a fence between me and the flying buttresses of the Abbey, absolutely dumbfounded. The chief musician had done some truly awe-inspiring work in building this golden masterpiece. And as I stood there looking up at this now famous church, I cried. Just a little, not a lot. Didn't want to freak out my friend. But still, I stood there crying. In that moment, I got to experience the overwhelming feeling of our creative, loving, boundary-defying God in its purest form all around me. That was a psalm-writing chief musician moment, loving moment if I've ever had one. What's amusing about that moment, though, is that it felt so awe-inspiring precisely because it was a moment that I never thought would happen in a million years. When I stood there looking at the stained glass of this church, it hit me that this is never where I would have expected to be. Standing in that exact spot felt like a miracle. This was the spacious place that God had brought me out to after having tried me, having laid burdens on my back, having walked with me through flood and through fire. That's what makes Psalm 66 so perfect. It reminds us that these spacious and life-giving spaces are just as much a product of the challenges God walks with us through as they are a reward for surviving those challenges. That's what the praise is all about. The bittersweet truth of living. The psalm describes life lived with and for God as it really is, not just how we wish it were. Though I wouldn't have thought about it this way at the time, my childhood was just as lived with God as that moment in front of the Abbey, even though there's literally nothing remotely similar about those two moments in my life. I grew up in a house that was often literally falling apart around me. At one point, our foundation had gotten so bad that there was a 2-inch gap between the ceiling and the top of the wall on one side of my room, so you could actually see outside of it. If my life has taught me anything, it's to revel in irony, and the fact that my deeply dysfunctional family lived in a house with a cracked foundation is an irony I will probably revel in until the day I die. I'll spare you the nastier details, but for our purposes today, what's important that is that as a child and as a teen, I experienced a great deal of emotional abuse and sexual grooming. And I was regularly reminded that I was the reason that we couldn't be a real family. This kind of messaging warped my brain and led to lots of choices on my part as a young adult that I still regret. So when I stood there that day in London, it wasn't just the wonder of being in front of a really old and famous building that got to me. It was knowing that deep inside me there was one of those spacious, that this was one of those spacious places to which God brings people after having tried them so vigorously. And that I, miracle of miracles, got to be in this spacious place. What I love about this psalm is that when the writer is describing the trials that God puts us through, he compares it to the way that silver is tried. I didn't know what this meant. I don't do science, so I looked it up. It turns out that silver is actually a byproduct of ore. Don't worry about what ore is. The pictures on the internet basically look like a big old rock composed of lead, copper, gold, and other valuable metals. So when you heat up the ore and then slowly allow it to cool, the silver rises to the surface and then can be scraped off and distilled so it's pure. So when the psalmist writes that God tries us as silver is tried, what they mean is that God melts the version of us that is mixed in with all this other stuff that isn't us until the person we were made to be rises to the surface and can be carefully cut away from all that truly isn't truly us. Isn't that profound? God tries us like silver, not to burn us, but to help piece apart who we are from all the other noise in the world. I love being able to think that the trials that I experienced growing up served as a heat source, separating what I am from what I'm not, so that when I stood in front of something so profoundly beautiful, a monument to God like this Gothic church, the truest part of me could see and be seen by God. I won't lie though. As I've thought about this psalm, I am troubled by the section that talks about how God intentionally puts us through pain and suffering. How could this loving, chief musician, creator of all things astounding God, intentionally choose to put me in situations where I was at the mercy of adults who were both cruel and sexual with me? It just doesn't jive. How can God be both the chief musician and the architect of our suffering? Is there any way out of this philosophical quagmire that this psalmist leads us into here? I think yes, and that maybe the answer can be found in the yet of this psalm. The author lists out all the things that God has had us go through, tried us like silver, trapped in a net, weighed down by burdens, having our heads literally run over, being brought through fire and through water, and what does the writer say next? They say, yet. Yet you have brought us out to a spacious place. Yet. What a surprising word. Yet implies the unexpected falling directly after what is expected. The unexpected being the spacious place. The expected being the pain and suffering. Humanity is accustomed to pain and suffering. Those things are universal and almost mundane in how often they occur in the human experience. This is why it comes before the yet. The miracle isn't in the pain, it's in the yet. The yet, the surprising joy, is being brought out to a spacious place where our grief and sorrow are met with God's love and delight, where they can meld together and form a new, stronger compound, informed by our pain and fortified by God's love in us. The yet tells me that God's most important action is not in creating suffering. God's biggest and most impressive act is in the wide open, deep breath inhale space that God creates for us after the crappy part has hit us. If anything, the yet implies that at worst, God just isn't standing in the way of suffering. That's all God is doing, not standing in the way of our suffering, and instead allowing us to feel the breadth of our human experience so that we can be purified like silver. Because without the bad stuff, without the pain, there would be no joy and no reason to even recognize God's presence in the world. What I mean by this is that joy is only joy because it has something to compare itself to. If there were only joy all of the time, what we'd really be experiencing is an endless forever of numbness. I think that maybe God can be okay with allowing us to experience the depths of pain. But what God cannot tolerate is us being numb to the wonder of our creation. Maybe that's the genius behind naming this psalm "To the Chief Musician." Music needs differing notes, speeds, rhythms, and movements for it to truly be music. If music were just the same note over and over again, this psalm would be entitled "To the Great Alarm Clock." Maybe we don't get a God that's only the good stuff all of the time because God is loving. A loving God wouldn't want you numb all of the time. Otherwise, how could you truly feel the music that God creates? The other funny thing about this psalm is that the psalmist writes that God has tested us literally right after they write that God has not let our feet slip. To be tested and to be held steady are both God's role in our lives. Notice too that the psalmist tells us that God is testing us, not me. The psalm could have very easily been written, "God has not let my feet slip, for you, O God, have tested me." But they didn't. They wrote us. "God has not let our feet slip, for you, O God, have tested us." As in, together, multiple, more than one, community. I think that this is important. When I stood there looking up at Westminster Abbey, I was so overwhelmed with the entire experience that I felt the least alone I'd ever felt in my whole life. And that's saying something for a kid who grew up hiding in her bedroom most of the time. When experiencing the awe of God, it's hard to feel alone. And I don't mean the feeling of being surrounded by people at a large gathering. I mean the not aloneness that is knowing precisely how small you are in the larger us that makes up God's people. We are tested together, our various personal trials melding together to form a perfect communal experience of loss. And because we have been melded together in this shared experience, our feet do not slip. They remain steady even as each of us individually might feel that we have fallen. We are held together when we hold ourselves together as a community of God's people. That's why our feet don't slip. We are a people, a corporal embodiment of God's love for creation that experiences the full range of human emotion and experiences, including trauma, grief, sorrow, heartbreak, hunger, and terror. This is the wonder of God. This isn't just a part of God that we have to tolerate to get to the part where things get good. This is a part of being God's people that should be, like in this psalm, praised beyond measure. We are a people tried by a loving and creative God in order to become our truest, most shiny silver selves, so that we may, when they occur, recognize those spacious places that God brings us to. Amen. Namaste. Thank you all for allowing me to share this message. I love you all so much, and I will talk with you soon. Happy Sunday.
Thank you so much, Victoria, for your words this morning. We are inspired. Will you join with me as a hymn of response as we sing "Your Grace Is Enough"?
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Yeah, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Great is your love and justice, God. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Yeah, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Yeah, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Yeah, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough, heaven reaching down to us, and your grace is enough for me, for me.
Wherever we are in God. Wherever we are in Christ, and Christ is in us. Wherever we are, the Spirit abides with us and in us. We go forth in peace and hope, upheld by God in every way. Let us go forth in faithfulness and trust. May all see the divine in and through us. Amen. Friends, let's join together as we sing the Irish blessing led by Adam. The words will be on your screen. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning.
May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm on your face, and the rain fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God